So it looks like this thing is recording as well. Pause recording, stop recording. All right, so those buttons there. Here we are again. Nice recording going. Got the split screen going, as you just mentioned. Kind of like how that setup looked for it. Those of you looking at the Facebook Live over here, got the keyboard in case anybody showed up. Seeing this how on one of your posts I commented, I was like, I disagree just to see if he would take the,
Oh.
for lack of a better term. And I was like, you know what? I'm gonna go ahead and play. I disagree. Show up at 3:30 if you want to hear why. But yeah,
Yeah,
got
yeah.
Tyler not here again, but he's here on this screen over here for those of you on Facebook. Those of you gonna be watching on YouTube should have a nice dual screen format here. And obviously I'll be listening on all the audio things, just hear both of us talking like normal.
Yeah, no, we me and D had a back and forth yesterday about something.
Oh, did you? I
And
must have missed that one. Like, I kind of like I get on things now and I'll scroll through and then sometimes I just miss a day. Like, it's kind of weird.
well, it was something stupid. Like it wasn't even over Facebook. It was about the Tony Khabib thing. And
Oh.
I made a point. I was like, well, until two people step in the octagon and the fight actually starts and it's not Tony Khabib, there's always a non-zero chance of something happening. And I said, now
That
that
was
change.
you. He was saying something about a non-zero chance about.
Exactly. And I was like, it could be like 0.000. I listed at like 20 zeros and then I put one. I was like, but just because it's got, I mean, just because it's not likely doesn't mean that we have to take it as all this stuff. And then he was like, well, I'm gonna ask some other people. I'm like, no, because you don't know what you're doing. You don't know how to formulate the question.
He
And
was
like
like, and
basically,
I was gonna be like, yes, it's a possibility. Like he was gonna say, is it possible for me to turn on my TV, be in the fifth inning of a ball game in blah 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 blah, and the score be 0-0 with no sports going? I'm like, dude, is it likely? Probably 99.99999% chance that it is not gonna happen.
yeah.
Is it possible that it might happen? Yes, because you know what? It might turn out that that was a live recording of a live game that just happened to turn on the TV at that exact same time that you said it was going to be. You know, I mean, is it going to
Well,
score
there,
that? No, but is there a
that's another
possibility?
situation I gave him. Like, and I told him, I was like, because the way the laws of nature work, everything has a non-zero possibility of happening. That could be anything from my skin turning green right now, all the way to, it not turning. I mean, it's a non-zero chance. Now, just because it's not likely doesn't mean that it's a 0% chance, and he doesn't understand that. And I was saying, he was like, well, what if I turned on my TV and watched baseball? I said, okay, my scenario was, I told him, I was like, okay, you could have been asleep this entire time, and you could have been hooked up to a computer that's been producing these memory or these false memories of being stuck in a coronavirus state where, everything was on quarantine. I was like, this could happen. Is it likely? No, it's not likely, but
It's
that's
not
not the
likely.
point.
Dude, we're living in the Matrix. Anything can happen, okay? Like,
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. I was like, it's a non-zero possibility. And then we kept going on, and he was like, well, could you change your age to 37 right now? And I'm like, of course I could. And he was like, I was like, if I go into space and I go to, like, say, I go near a black hole or something and I come back, I haven't aged but maybe one day, but here, X amount of time has passed by. So on planet Earth, it would be the year, whatever year I'll be 35 in.
yeah.
But technically, I would be 35 then because my birth certificate said 2020, and the allotted amount of time would have passed, and all that. And he just his thing was, you haven't proven to me. And I'm like, it's not about proving. I was like, the just because you don't accept the fact, the things I'm laying forward, doesn't mean that they're not accurate.
I was gonna say I can make it happen a whole lot easier. I mean, I have this thing called Photoshop. I'll change your
Yeah.
driver's license. I can do any of that.
Exactly. I mean, there's.
He was like, legally, I was like, yes, it can happen.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of scenarios. I mean, are they likely? No, they're not likely. But due to the laws of nature, there's a non-zero chance of just about anything happening. And
Right.
then I got him, what got him really mad is because this is stuff that, me studying philosophy, this is stuff that I actually,
It's kind of what you do.
study and talk about. Yeah, it's stuff that it's kind of what I do. And So I know the I know how the arguments go and stuff. And I got him in checkmate. And yeah. He got really uncomfortable with that because it just made him mad. Basically, what I did is I tied in one thing that, you know, I believe. And I think this is why he got mad, because this is not a reflection of my beliefs or anything, but I tied in religion to it.
Yeah.
And it made him really uncomfortable, because it got to the point where he either had to concede one thing or concede another, and he would have to concede that, you know, I am correct, or two, that his beliefs are not true, and
he wasn't willing to go there. Very
yeah, and it's like, and he got so mad about that.
Yeah, because like you said, he hadn't had the classes on it, and like all those debates happened in those classes, and you have to detach yourself from not necessarily logical thinking, but you have to detach yourself from emotional thinking and other things when it comes to different things. And not take things as a personal attack or criticism type thing. It's just like an opening of the mind for, is there a possibility for such things?
It's
whatever.
It's a game of chess with logic is all it is. It's you gotta make sure what you're saying logically follows.
Very true.
That's his thing, is he doesn't know how to do that. And then when I point that out to him, he gets really frustrated and he gets really mad. And then he tries to push it to other directions to like cling to anything. And I was telling him, I was like, you're not as good at this as I am. And I'm not even compared to some of the other ones. Like, there's some obviously great thinkers out there who are far more, you know, educated with that than I am.
Yeah.
But he didn't understand that. And like, when I was trying to tell him, I was like, there was actually one point where I told him, I was like, the point you're making right now, you're invoking these two principles. But the problem is those two principles literally contradict your entire, you know, claim that you're making. And I'm trying to tell you this. And he just, he got irritated and he didn't know how to do it. So
yeah,
I gave up. I just was like, whatever.
All right. Well, it seems how like even social distancing or not, we still find ways to get off topic completely. So a couple other things. Well, look, I guess let's go ahead and get into wrestling talk, and then I had a couple other, I guess, off-topic things to go into as well. The first one was, I think the biggest news, you had mentioned it, this kind of what spearheaded all this, the whole NCAA not granting another year of eligibility for those that were, for winter sports athletes. That would be basketball, wrestling, and what else would be winter sports wise? Because they said spring sports would be, because they haven't even got a chance to start their season. So it makes sense.
I'm not sure. I think those are the only two winter sports that.
So basically,
yeah.
Basketball, wrestlers, there's got to be something else, because the way they say it with winter sports, there's got to be something else that we're not really catching. You know, I mean, not to, you know, downgrade any other sports other than wrestling being the greatest sport there is. But whoever was a winter athlete, seasons got cut short. And when I say got cut short, for some it was for NCAAs, for the most part, it was the postseason. Okay. Mm-hmm. So they're not granted another year's worth of eligibility, meaning they cannot compete in their national championships. One of the things that the argued was like, why should they? They got to compete their whole season. It wasn't like, you know, why should they get a whole nother year? I was like, well, you just said they got to do their whole season. Technically, they didn't get to do their whole season. But before we get into those arguments, they came out and said no extra year of eligibility. So basically, where it ended was the end of that season for that year. Conference titles, whatever, are handed out. I guess in the history books now, there's just going to be an asterisk. It says COVID-19, no NCAA tournament for any sports that happened, I guess, as far as the history books. Now, what were your thoughts? I mean, I know Spencer Lee was the big thing, and I think that's the biggest, kind of the biggest thing. But first and foremost, I'll go out and say it, you know, past Spencer Lee, who's not a senior, who still has a wrestling career in front of him, I, like you said, feel for those who are seniors this year. Now ending their senior collegiate athletic career on a not a down note of having a poor performance, not a down note of having got sick, not a down note of having to deal with an injury. Not, you know, I feel for any of those things that happen: sickness, illness, injury, freak accident, God forbid, a missed weight. You know, just anything that happens within the regular scope things to a senior and them not getting a chance to compete, whether they win, lose, draw, whatever it is, but the not being able to compete, I feel bad for any of those people any given year, anytime something like that happens. I mean, nobody wants to get chicken pox a week before the NCAA tournament and not be able to go out and compete. That'd be a horrible thing. You know, you missed out on your senior year's thing. It's something that in this case also you put in the work for, you had to qualify for. So I really especially feel for the seniors that this is affected toward. I think the majority of our talk is going to go to the could of implication that this now has, like as far as Spencer Lee being a four-timer. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, he's the only one that this currently affects, minus if there was a freshman who would have won it this year who could go on to win the next 3 years. Every year in there at least, I mean, now that's another one we get to check out. Is there always a freshman that wins it once a year or something like that? Or is there, or is it just like every couple years freshmen win it? Or,
I mean, there's a few freshmen we could think of this year that.
Oh, no, I got one right off the bat. Sammy Sasso.
Yeah, that was the example I was going to use. And then that also that cat from Penn State.
You got Sammy Sasso. You got the Jack dude from Penn State who beat the other red shirt that was pulled for Iowa, Ava Saad. I can't remember because the guy from Penn State beat Ava Saad, but those are two freshmen that got their stuff pulled, and they don't pull red shirts without believing somebody can make that run and do it, you know?
Yeah.
So any of our true freshmen or freshmen who either had a red shirt pulled or were going into it, I also gonna lump them in with Spencer Lee, and since like in a way you have taken a chance for them to have something else special happen that only has happened four other times in NCAA history for wrestling, a chance at a four timer.
This is gonna sound kind of
Spencer Lee.
Yeah. No. Go ahead and finish.
And the biggest of that group being Spencer Lee, because Spencer Lee's already won it twice. This would have been his third. Right, yeah, would have been his third, then he would have had to have done it one more time. Now, at first, the option was, dude, does he want to go through that grind again if they give it to him? I didn't even think that they wouldn't, you know, like, do they want, you know, because that would have been like a total of 5 years to get four championships, you know. Now, no matter what happens, he goes out and wins it next year, which who's to say he doesn't, but like, if he goes out and wins it next year, is there going to be an asterisk next to his name, three-timer? Star, COVID, Hodge Trophy winner, would have, could have, maybe should have, possible four-timer. I mean, talk about getting as close to it as you can get, you know, minus losing it your senior year type thing, you know, I mean.
I'm going to joke about this real quick, and but then it's going to kind of lead it. But it's kind of funny because now I can officially tell Quasi that I was correct about Shinzo not being a three-timer. I joke about that, but in all honesty, though, I do hate that for Shinzo as much as I really rag on him. I mean, there was a possibility he could have been a three-timer.
Yeah, which is like, also, I mean, it's not as hard as being a four-timer, but by no means is it an easy feat.
No, that's still like elite category of
big deals out of him. Being a one-timer, being a two-timer, then to be a three-timer, like the next best thing to a four. I mean, just the opportunity taken from these people is what gets me. And that's the reason why I also put on your post. Is like, I disagree with this. And I do and I don't. I disagree because I wanted the argument and wanted to see if he would show up to see the reasons why. But I also disagree with the sense that I think that it shouldn't be everybody is automatically get another year of eligibility. I think it should be those that qualified for the postseason, meaning like if your season ended before the postseason and you were a senior, or you were, hell, if you were a freshman and you didn't make it to the NCAA tournament, I don't think that you should qualify for another year of eligibility next year. Okay. Or however that, you know, rolls out. Cause if you had two more years, whatever, I don't think you should have those that qualify for the postseason tournament, I feel should have a stipulation where if you choose to stay in school and if you choose to make this grind again, cause it's a grind. That was the thing we're talking about. It's like how many would want to do it? You have the opportunity and option to at least try for it. You will give you a year for those that have earned that right to have been to that tournament, to be to that stage, but unfortunately got taken away from you. And the reason why I say this is also because this is not a commonplace thing. This virus, this COVID-19, this coronavirus has affected us nationally, the world globally, in a way that has not been done before, like with things shutting down and things of this nature. So I don't think this is like a thing where like, hey, you had the choice, you could have gone, but you chose not to, so therefore we're not gonna give you another year. No, they canceled things. We've shut things down. We're going to e-learning for schools. I imagine we probably will be for the rest of the year, but we'll find out later on. But you know, like society is making a change right now, and this is not a choice that they were given. So therefore, that's why I think that I disagree with them not granting the eligibility for like all winter athletes. Well, no, I agree with them if they say not all winter athletes, but I think like those that made it to the postseason, I think should be granted a choice of taking another year of eligibility if they wanted it. That's just me. That's where I am. That's, I think, you know, when you have something taken like that, it's not an athlete thing. This is not a, you know, hey, it happens, you get injured. Hey, it happens, you get sick. Hey, it happens, you get something happen. Hey, it happens, your school messed up and they violated some code and now you guys are dinged and you're out. It was none of those things. It was a thing beyond anybody's control. This is a completely new waters to everybody. And I think they should have that option too, if those that made it. Now, I'm sorry. If you didn't make it to NCAAs and you're thinking you're going to try to get another year of eligibility to try to make it still, nah, that's gaming the system. I'm not trying to game the system. I'm just trying to give those that have earned a shot an ability to get that shot to maybe earn that four-timer. Hell, to earn that chance to be a three-timer if you wanted to go for it, you know, or whatever it may be. So that's why I'm saying on it, and that's why I think that they should do that.
Would that also go down to alternates? Like alternates for the tournament and stuff, because then
they already had their selection committee. They already pulled the wild cards in. I think they already had the brackets. If your name is in that bracket, you would have that ability to have the to be able to go, because they already did the wild cards and pulled all those guys in. It'd been a lot harder if they hadn't made it that far. But like, oh, well, so-and-so was going to go to the selection committee and they might have gotten in. Can we give them a year of eligibility? Nope. Don't even have to worry about that. They made it so far and so close. Brackets were drawn. We had them in hand. We were getting giddy about them. And then they were taken away. It wasn't like we were still a week or so ahead of that and not even near a chance of going, you know, and still trying to figure out who was going. I think we had our number of people going, and those people should have the opportunity if they wanted it.
Speaking of brackets, you still want to fill them out and then just kind of do like a show of like the kind of, you know, just like a fantasy bracket thing?
I got to find them again. I think I might have gotten mad as we were cleaning at the virus.
Yeah, like we can just like fill them out and be like, all right, we believe this. And then just kind of, I don't know, maybe do like a little vote system. We could do like the who we think
would be. Or actually, I was thinking about one I meant to bring. Did you see the one with the wrestling singlets? Mm-hmm. The wrestling singlet bracket? I'll find it. I'll send it to you. And I think we can have a little bit more fun with that. And we can have our own, like, who do you think, like, this was like somebody already had theirs filled out.
But, and we can say whether we agree with them, not agree with them, and we can kind of play our own little system of who we had going up against who on the scene.
I saw you tag me in one thing where it was the warm-ups.
The warm-ups, yeah, I did tag you in that one because I thought it was cool that it had it went and had like a Clemson warm-up, and I was like, dude, that's retro. Yeah,
that one was retro. That one's kind of like obscure too. I was like, that's kind of cool.
I know, and I was like, dude, I could see that happening again. You know?
I'll be honest, between that and Lehigh, those are my two favorites. There's something about the Lehigh warm-up.
That
brown, like the short sleeve with a collar. I was like, there was something about it. I was like, I kind of like it.
Yeah. Remember when Ohio State brought back the robes?
Yeah. No, they didn't have that one on there. I was surprised about that.
So.
But no, like Michigan's is – I like it. It's kind of plain, but I feel like there were other warm-ups in there that were far better.
I mean, I put my top three, I think, in there. I put, like, I liked Okie State's. I liked the Clemson one, and I can't remember what the other one was. I put in there now that we're talking about it. It was one that I don't think you would have thought
of. We can do that, though. We can do the singlet challenge. I like that one, actually.
All right, I'll look that up. I'll send you that. I'll send you that file and let you run through it. And then for if nothing else, next week we'll talk singlets and go through that. And we can kind of go through that one for next week.
Whichever one wins, that's the one we're going to make our new design. How about that?
Although I did I told you I sent that one off to G, right?
Yeah.
Spartanburg in the back, and he liked it. And he actually showed it to the athletic director. So,
yeah. Really?
I mean, well, part of it is, I think, what else is he doing right now, too? We're all homeschooling or e-learning, so he has time to email stuff off and, you know.
I wonder if he's watching wrestling videos like me.
Probably. I bet he is. So,
yeah.
So,
see, that's what gets me, man, is, like, I'll watch some of these tutorials, and, yeah, I mean, they're cool, and it's like I'm doing extra learning. But it's kind of making it worse because it's like I want to now get back in the gym, and then like I might see some good scraps, like some practices, and I'm like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
But
no, in ways it helps, in ways it makes you just want to get back out there some more. So
exactly, because I want to body lock someone and try this new little suplex that guy showed with the arm drag, reach over and like.
I mean, I can only chunk Henry so many times like that and make it easy.
Yeah. No, I hate that. I hate it for the guys in the NCAA tournament. Honestly, though, as much as I want to agree and say that you should give eligibility to everybody who qualified, there's a part of me that just – and I hate using this, like, it's not fair phrase just because it's – yeah, because it sounds kind of like a cop-out. But at the same time, I understand why they did it. Like they had gone through their entire season.
I don't understand it. I'm just saying, like, I get it. But in a perfect world type case, I think this is one of those few times where I think it's an extreme situation. It's a completely different thing than anything we've seen before. This is nothing.
And I'll be honest.
Yeah.
Your take on it as far as like granting eligibility to all those qualified through the postseason, I'll be honest, I don't think that the NCAA committee, I don't think they thought of that option. I mean, because this is such an unprecedented case.
It's for everybody who competed this year to get a whole new year. And I'm not even saying that those that are in the tournament this year would take that chance, would take that thing. I mean, say you do have a freshman who's in there. Heck, he might wrestle three more years, you know, be looking at graduating, moving on, and his passion, desire in there, and he was only an All-American 2 years and a placer. He may not want to take that extra year of eligibility, you know. So by granting an option for it, it's not a you have to take it, and I think it would be something that – this would be like, you know, they'd be asterisked in the NCAA thing. We get to one more year type thing and be like, hey, you had the opportunity to compete this year. Are you taking that or are you not taking that? You know?
Yeah.
Okay, you are? Cool. You're good. If not, no worries. We're done. You know?
Yeah, no, I mean, I get that. But it just seems to me like I guarantee the NCAA committee, no one thought of that idea. I mean, that means that you have some revolutionary ideas. Shocking. But
I mean, coming up with it.
Because if we were to grant Lee, like, just say, let's use Lee for the example. Say we were to grant him an extra year of eligibility. What would that do to his legacy if he either loses that year, or what if he wins in that fifth year? Does that just show that he's that dominant that even through 5 years
of this years?
Horrible grind in the Iowa wrestling room, that he's still able to beat everybody in that weight and still continue to be a four-timer? Or do we sit there and say,
if he did it though, like, you can imagine, like, he'd be four and a half timer. He did it four times, and then a year where he did
it, would, I hate to say it, but it would almost
make him,
it would
better.
Almost lead to the conversation, is he the best of all the four timers?
Because he was looking at having to do it five times.
And it's like, so that means he went through an extra year of grind to get it. I mean, you could still argue that Kale, because Kale is undefeated in all his 4 years, but I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting dynamic to think about, because if Lee were to do that, and that fifth year he wins, it's like, oh, he's a four-timer, but he's going through this grind for 5 years, and that just shows the level of mental toughness. And but then again, he also could realistically lose. You get some hotshot freshmen come in and beat him, and
you know. And as the curve that wrestling is, and guys getting better and better as they first show up in college, and the younger they are, you know, I mean, they're getting better.
Here's the other issue. Here's the other issue. Say he gets that extra year of eligibility. Say he gets injured. Does he get an extra year on top of that?
Yeah. And then he's, like, 26 years old. Saying that, like, hey, this is the, you know, because – the same thing with those medical red shirts, they have to do those case by case. And I'd say, like, there'd be an asterisk saying, you know, if you got medical, then you're asking for a medical one. No, we already gave you one because of this. We're not going to give you another one on top of it. So I think, again, I think there's ways around all those other problems. You just have to look and spend the time to delve into it and say, hey, if they want a medical, we're going to say no because you chose to take the extra one from the COVID year, you know, call it the COVID redshirt, whatever you want to call it. I don't know. I also think for us, it's a different thing than it is for, say, basketball players. Because let's be honest, a lot of those basketball players, if they're at that high level, like a Spencer Lee, they're looking at going pro after a year anyway. You know, like they were only there for a year. Whether they come back the next year or not, that's always just always been a money issue. Whether they're going to come back to school to be with their team for another year, or whether they're going to go to the NBA draft, you know. For us, we don't have that. So it's not like, hey, I'd stick around, but I've got my pro career. You know, for us, their pro career is a lot of times staying at that school and then just competing in the RTC, and unfortunately not for multimillion-dollar contracts like these guys who are going to the draft are getting. So I think it's a unique situation that could also be – some would say that's unfair to let those wrestlers do it, but let's be honest, the basketball players and such that are that good and those superstars, they were already planning on leaving anyway. They're not going to come back to not get paid another year, you know? Whereas,
speaking of, you were talking about, you know, the ending of boat season. Do you follow Chael Sonnen on Instagram or anything like that?
What do I follow him on? Because his name pops up on a lot of things that I follow, but I
was like, I follow his podcast, and I also follow him on social media. But
he runs podcast in a long time though. His was on my
so stuff. Good. I love it.
I mean, but it's they were so long. They were kind of like Joe Rogan's. They were long, and he had a lot of them. And it was kind of
what he does now is they're segmented. So you have basically what happens is he'll have, it's no longer just like constant monologue. What it is he'll have a topic, he'll record his take on it. It could be anywhere from, I think they all ranged an hour long now, so he could talk about something for 3 minutes, then he gets a next topic, and he can talk about that for 10 minutes if he wants. But they're basically segmented, so you can, if you subscribe to him on like YouTube and stuff, he actually uploads them, the podcast segmented videos, so you can like click on what you want to hear from it, which I like. Is but anyway, he does Submission Underground, and they actually did an event the other night. But the way they had to do it is because of law now, there cannot be more than four people in a gathering. So what they did is they set up all the cameras. They controlled the cameras from a truck, he had to sit in a separate room and do commentary while getting live feed from the camera. And the only people allowed were in the room were the scorekeeper, a ref, and the two athletes.
Yeah.
And they just did it in an empty room.
It's interesting. Interesting.
Yeah, we could do that for the NCAA tournament.
Yeah. One match at a time.
Yeah, just one match at a time. You'll have one ref. You'll have a scorekeeper.
Yeah, this is going to take 20 days. You get 20 pounds from day one. Okay?
Yeah.
There will be no weigh-ins. You just show up.
This is going to be UFC style. This will be UFC style. Open weight.
Now, I did think about this one. What'd you think about this? Somebody posted it out there. Midlands next year. Scratch Midlands. They're going to keep it as – they would keep it as Midlands. Everybody who qualified for the NCAA tournament come to Midlands.
I like that. That would be an interesting idea. But then, like, you have that argument of two grueling tournaments in 1 year like that. I'm not saying that Midlands isn't a grueling tournament, but I say even though Midlands is a top-notch tournament, it still doesn't carry that same weight as
it doesn't. But imagine, like, it'd be as close to our NCAA tournament for makeup from last year as we're gonna get, though. I was like, and somebody was like, you know, not everybody's gonna be there, not everybody be at the same weight, blah blah. I'm like, dude, if you get 70% of the people, then it's still gonna be a great tournament. Like I'm saying, like, so say you were at, you know, DeSanto and all those guys, they're all at 133. Say next year one of them bumps up to, you know, 41. Well, then I think then they just can't go to Midlands that year. Like, they're just going to keep as much – I think they should just keep as much of the bracket as you could the same and then just go with it from there. If you're jumping weights, I mean, it's kind of like a mop. I mean,
you could have Chinzo in there because, if I'm not mistaken, Midlands – all right, I don't think they do it anymore, do they?
Because you could have the – that was the other thing. That's right. Because those that did graduate can come. So if you graduate, you could still come.
Do they still do that or are they
– I think they still do because they've been talking about Ben Askren and Dylan Palacio and a lot of people, like, why haven't they been back in it yet? So
Oh, man, just imagine. We could set this up. We'll have to start a Facebook group, kind of like the Storm Area 51. Get everyone from the tournament to compete in Midlands next. I mean, even this, because the seniors could get their second chance. I mean, they don't have to technically go through that grind.
I'm saying it's all. And then if you win it, and then, like, say if Spencer Lee goes and he wins it, then I say we asterisk him and give him a trophy, and he does become a four-timer in 1 year.
Yeah. the technical four-timer.
Technical four-timer, and he does it in 1 year.
Four-timer. Yeah.
How amazing would that be? All right.
That would be actually really – I'm sure we can get this rolling. We have to –
So you like that one too then, huh? All right.
And yeah, let's do that.
I stole that one. I saw that one. Somebody tweeted and I was like, dude, we need to run with that. I like that. Get all the seniors. Yeah. You can have those guys come post-grad. You know, you just got to be at the same weight you were last year. And if you fit in there, great. If not, we'll take 70% of you at that tournament. And it'll be an awesome tournament.
Oh, yeah. Just imagine people like getting to see a postgraduate Chinzo. You know, where all he gets to do is just, like, train against someone like a Marinelli. Like, that would just be
That'd be a fun tournament to watch. That'd be a fun one to watch. So, but, all right, other wrestling news, I think, and this kind of surprises me that it's still happening, is, like, amongst all of the COVID and people not going out, there's obviously lots of this. Lots of phone conferencing, lots of Zooming. Lots of texting, talking, and everything else because Pendleton from Arizona State is now heading up to Oregon State, taking over that program. So I think that's another big coaching move. And in all honesty, I thought Kolak going to Navy was big and it was surprising. But I was like, you know what? I don't know how much more of this we're going to see right now. Like, are people making changes right now? Like, how much is going on behind the scenes with everybody on quarantine, you know? You know, and we'll talk about this in a little bit. Not lockdown, but in quarantine. Like, what other jobs are up for grabs right now? Normally, you kind of like – again, look at the NCAA tournament and see who did what, which team fell off, which team rose in stock, and you kind of – the coaches move from there. But now that the tournament didn't happen, I beg to wonder what other programs are do we see make a shuffle? Who else is, you know, who else is going to move? Like, without seeing the tournament, it makes everything so hard for us right now as the fan. Because without having seen the tournament, without saying, man, this team fell off, or dude, did you see them come up? And look at those guys. Where, he could go coach somewhere. Who's going to be the next coach here? Like, or there, or, you know, dude, we had somebody from this school in a little bit. We need, I don't know. I just thought it was kind of cool.
Pendleton, you mentioned going to Oregon State. That's an interesting move, I think, because Oregon State has a – I mean, they've always had some pretty solid guys. Who's the one that beat Lee a few years ago? Bresser?
Bresser. And Hesse, at heavyweight. Those were the last two big-name guys that they've had. And they weren't a program that hadn't had people too. So I think – it's another move out west, building more programs or rebuilding.
Exactly. I was going to say, I think we'll see their recruiting kind of improve from this move, and I'm excited to see it. But Navy, I want to talk about that one real quick. Kolak going to Navy.
Yeah.
That is actually one I'm interested in seeing because Carey, he's we've seen what he's done with Campbell. I kind of want to see him at this, at this D1 level with a, fairly good team. Navy usually has – they usually have a solid core of guys on their, on their roster, and they usually have some – they've had a few cats make it pretty far in the tournament.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder what Kolak is – what he's going to bring to Navy. I want to see what that's all about.
Because it's a different thing going to one of those schools, like Army, Navy, Air Force – you know, those guys, they've always had a couple of standout guys that, like you said, make it pretty far. But to be real, getting recruited there for wrestling or whatever is not like your main thing. Like, they're going in to become officers in, to serve our country. So it's not like we're quite getting – well, at the same time, I take all that back. Never mind. We have our Army team and all those guys in Greco, Mango, that, like, can do well, while still having a career. So I think it's going to be interesting to try to see one of those core programs like become like how far can you make it as a top team? Like, what's the recruiting like, and how is that all, how much does that take effect on it? I think it's just kind of interesting.
Yeah. I know those programs, usually their recruiting, it takes a hit just because of what happens when you accept, like when you do take on that responsibility of going to those academies, there are other things that come behind it,
Yeah.
I know, what is it? They have to serve, what is it, 2 years, 3 years?
I think four. I think when you go, it's like four and then four reserve.
Four. That does tend to turn people away.
Yeah, unless that's what you want to do. Speaking of like those programs, maybe completely off the track, did you see the comedian if not, I'll send you the link to him. He's funny. What is his name, though? I can't remember his name. But he was talking about, like, when he was in high school, it was either Marine or Army recruiter came to him and was like, dude, we heard you wrestle. And he's like, yeah, I wrestle. He says, you know what? If you come sign up for the Army and you pass the test and you make it in the Army, you can just wrestle full-time in the Army and we'll just pay you to wrestle. And he was like, did you see this one?
But I already.
Dude was like, dude, do you not know who I am? Like, I am like 3 and 30. I am literally the worst dude in the state of Ohio, right? He was like, bleepity bleep, man. Like, for real, my choices were either go home to the trailer park after school or go hang out in the wrestling room. Dude, so I just stayed at school and went to the wrestling room. My matches, they were easy. He went on, my matches were easy. I wasn't even trying to win. I roll up on out there. I see the other guy getting all warmed up and be like, ooh, like, listen to some NWA getting jacked up. I'm like, oh, man, this ain't that kind of match. This is more of a Kenny G style kind of match, man. Ain't going to take that long. Don't worry, man. It ain't going to take that long.
What's even more funny about that is those Marine recruiters tell him he could wrestle full time. That's not going to happen.
But they definitely not. Like, I don't know, we had Marine recruiters come into the room in Chattanooga. They were like, you're the type of people we're looking for. You guys can handle this work. And I mean, it's not a bad tactic to recruit from, like, the toughest sport there is.
To be some of the toughest. But to tell a high school kid they get to wrestle full time is a little bit misleading there.
Okay, let's see. It's recruiters, and it's just what they do, you know. So
yeah, I know.
But you got to check that video out. Look up wrestler recruited by Marines or something, or I'll find the link to it or whichever. It's funny because he was like, the dude that I lost, I'm going to give the whole thing away. It's like, the dude I lost to, or the dude that I beat three times, it's the same dude. And the reason why is because we was both trying to lose. Coach, man, he trying to lose. Coach is like, what do you mean he trying to lose? Like, coach, I tried to lose. I know what it looks like when you trying to lose. This guy tried to lose.
We had two guys that wrestled a couple years ago. You remember that? Or one guy, but him and another cat from another school. They had those battles. And I was like, are y'all just trying to see who can not win this one?
Yeah, pretty much. So, but that, you got to check him out. That guy was funny. And then the other big news was Frank Molinaro, G-Hulk, he announced his retirement. And, you know, wasn't necessarily surprised with the announcement of his retirement, especially after the Olympics postponed again. I think it's great that he announced it. I think our sport needs more of that when our guys, whether you are the top dude for real, or whether you're the Jordan Burroughs, Jordan Oliver, or whether you're him who's, I don't want to say not top tier, but like, you know, he wasn't quite making the team, but he was in the mix for the team. You know, he's not Kyle Snyder, he's not, you know, those guys that are at the top of that list right now, but you threw him in that, whatever weight you threw him in, man, you knew it was going to be a mix-up, and he could make that team if he got the right draws and he did the right things. He's fun to watch as a wrestler. Just kudos to him for going ahead and making the announcement to retire so that he didn't become another one of those wrestlers. I hate it when they retire, but they don't really ever say anything. It's just kind of like they just kind of fade away in the night and like, hey, what happened to so-and-so? He hadn't, like, signed up for another tournament in forever. Kudos to him for making it verbal and saying, hey, yes, I retired. I think we need more of that so that we can give more recognition to our guys. Whether you haven't made the team the last 2 years or whether you didn't quite make your goal, like, you don't have to retire on top is what I'm saying. It's like, yeah, you don't have to be like, okay, I made it to the Olympics, I'm retiring now. No, dude, if you hadn't made the team in 2 years, but you're still one of the top guys, hadn't been in it, and your face has been out there, and we've been following you, and like I said, I don't want to, like, downplay him any at all or not give him his proper dues or say that he's not the top guy or top tier guy, but I'm just saying, like, I want to see more people go ahead and announce when they're retiring so that we can give them proper credit and proper dues for, say, thank you for the time given to our sport and allowing us to watch you and allowing us to watch you act the fool when he was on that Chattanooga mat, when he was everything, you know, when he doing all the craziness and all that kind of stuff. So I kind of liked that he did that. So I think we just need more of that for our sport, just so we, like I said, so we can give credit to our guys that are out there doing their thing.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that. Like, I hate when we see guys. And that's also, it seems like, I'm kind of curious why he retired. I mean, I think I know. I mean, it's not probably not a mystery. But I don't know. It just – I kind of wish we would keep more guys around. It seems like we get them for X amount of time.
Or the guys move off to MMA, you know, and that's kind of like the retirement. It's not really a retirement. It's like they just left, you know.
Yeah. So, they went to greener pastures.
Yeah, so and, props to people like Frank Marinello. Not Marinelli, but Marinello. G-Hulk, for not only sticking with wrestling and coaching and moving on and doing and committing everything to it and then giving us the chance to say thank you and, you know, actually making the announcement to retire instead of like, well, we'll see what happens. How many of these guys are going to go off to MMA and leave us and then come back to us and coach and do stuff? Or how many just, like I said, they just quit going to tournaments and we just don't hear about it anymore?
Yeah. I still wish we could have seen him go just a little bit more. Again, that's the selfish part of me.
Selfish part, especially with things going one more year right now.
Yeah, it's like, come on, man. Let's just
see what happens with one more set of qualifiers, one more thing. So let's make these brackets for our qualifying for the national team like that much more exciting one more time.
Speaking of retirements, I don't know if you saw in the MMA news, but DC has talked about if this virus stretches out into the fall.
Yeah,
he said he's probably going to retire. He said he's not going to wait around.
You know, and that's...
He's in his 40s now.
That's the thing. There's some of those guys that are like that, that are right there on that borderline. And I think that's one of the things with this virus with Jordan Burroughs was a big thing. And he was like, dude, you can't get ready to be an Olympic athlete riding a bike and, you know, doing push-ups and pull-ups at home, you know, like on quarantine or doing stuff on your own, which makes sense. So he was kind of down about this. And then it being pushed back 1 year. And for him, I think we got lucky in the sense that he's like, I'm still doing it because it's only a year. That he's still able to do this because it's only a year. But imagine if this was next year, him a year older and that having hit or something like that. We might not be seeing him be like, dude, I can't do it another year. You know, like there's only so much.
Now, I somewhat disagree with him saying that, you know, you can't be an Olympic, you know, you can't train for the Olympics, you know, on a bike at the house and all this. The reason I disagree, I mean, in the normal circumstances, he's 100% correct. Like, I can't do push-ups and pull-ups in my house and, you know, go wrestle for, you know, world championship. That's yeah. not going to happen. But given the circumstances and given how not only us, but every country is on lockdown. It's not yeah. just America.
No, it'd be
it's
a, not just it'd be an even playing well. Minus the Russia's going to come get me again. Minus all the supplements, Russia's feeding all their guys while they're at home right now.
Yeah, I mean Russia. They're locked down. Like you can't go in it. They're locking stuff down. But then again, when you get there next year, it'll probably be the least conditioned Olympics we've seen, where you got guys kind of gassing a little early.
Yeah.
But I mean, still, it is still going to be an even playing field for the most part. Or let me rephrase it. It'll be a normal playing field for the most part. The Russians will still be juiced up to the gills.
Yeah, they'll still be their home supplements.
Yeah.
So, but I think that's about it for all that kind of stuff. I was going to say kind of also playing off of all this a little bit. My man, Nick Tucker finally got, he mentioned doing his podcast, Tucker.life, because his last name was Tucker. He mentioned like coming on the show and I was like, hey, us doing this Zoom thing be perfect. So maybe I mentioned to him, I think just a little too late, said, hey, we're getting ready to go on at like 3:30, but we can plan this out. We'll get him on the show next week. You can talk a little bit about his show of Tucker.life and give his aspect on things. Another wrestling coach. And when I listened to his episode yesterday, doing the same thing that, and again, that's why like we have our, we're going to call it the Cerebrus Network, like-minded people, things we've all talked about, common goals, just the ability to take advantage of circumstances and wanting to get better, you know, and doing what you can to get better. For him, it was like family time, establishing a routine and doing things as a family, still being able to work out, figuring that time out to do those things and take advantage of what we have and what we've been put into in a way. So,
you know what? Speaking of this, like using the Zoom thing, this was always an issue that we kind of had trying to figure out about bringing other people on.
Yeah.
This would be the perfect time. Like back when, because remember Quasi reached out to Victoria Anthony and she said she would be down.
Yeah.
Come on. This would be perfect. I mean, you're close with David Taylor, you know, or Nick Suriano. Like you can like shoot them a little DM and be like, hey, do you want to hop on for a little bit? Just
to how's doing? You want to get on for a minute? Yeah. So, all right. Well, we'll jump on that too. I'm gonna get Nick, and then I'll jump on the others. We'll ADT.
Yeah. I'll message like Ed Ruth, Adam Kuhn, all those guys.
And we will come up. We'll get a list of questions. Get some people. Hey, how are you handling things? But we will have a list of questions for you. We'll get you on. Like now that we got this kind of figured out, you know, with this model, I think that'd be an awesome thing to do. So.
Yeah. I mean we could blow up after that, you know.
Yeah,
we could make some money, and then we could open up the compound and
the gym, and then have all those guys that come on the show. You guys can all get guest clinic at the compound. We'll put you up, you know, take care of you once all this is done, and we can actually social gather, which I've been working on the backyard of making a nice social gathering spot for when all this is done, and let it be known that if you are going out unnecessarily. Now, when I say going out, go out, go exercise, go run, go do your stuff, because you can do that. I fully believe while social distancing, you know, I go for a bike ride, I go for a run. I'm not running much right now, but if I go out for a bike ride or I go for a walk with the family, we can see other families, we can be out, we can be on the other side of the street, we can wave, we can move on, great. Okay. If you have to go to the store, I understand grocery stores, obviously. If you have to go to another store, try not to. I kind of went to Home Depot the other day, even though I was like, oh, do I not? But I was like, you know what? Let me drive by, see if it's busy. It's not too busy. And then also at the same time, I got some sand and some outdoor stuff. So I was able to push cart, stay completely away from everybody, you know, try to do that. But that's kind of like a bare minimum. Also, the other reason why I did do that was like we needed to get some like garden stuff for our kids for growing. So for our homeschooling / educational stuff, learning about things. So in a way that kind of was not just trying to get out, but trying to take care of the backyard, but also like that did have an educational purpose for the kids, for us, for with the e-learning and homeschooling and all those kind of things. But if you got to go out and do things, like really avoid people. But my big kicker is like, I still see people, like I think going to other people's houses just to go hang out for whatever reason. You see people going out. If I see that you're just going out to go social gather or go do things, let me know. Now I'm probably going to judge you and be like, dude, all we had to do was just chill out, stay away from each other as much as possible. And like I said, I know I went to Home Depot to go get a couple of those things, but I think I kind of felt justified and like I scoped it out first and then to make sure how it was and if there was going to be a bunch of people, I wasn't even going to go in. But I also was getting some educational things for the family as well. That being said, I think I see there's probably people that are just going out like it's free willy-nilly, like it's no big deal, and they're going to every other little shop in town and store and wondering why they can't go inside places and everything else. I'm like, guys, it's not the time for that. This is time to do what we said for like, but stay inside, not inside. We're in quarantine, not lockdown. You can go outside. You can go get some fresh air. You can go for a walk. You can get out of your house still. You just don't need to be going near everybody and their grandmother. And then find a way to get better yourself. Like spend some time on yourself, read, draw, work out, you know, just do something. Be positive. That was his thing, is being positive right now on Tuckered Out. Ours, I think we said for Cerebrus was get better, you know, find a way to get yourself better mentally, physically, emotionally, whatever it is. His was stay positive. So I like both of those. So,
yeah. No, I mean, the being positive, it's a good thing just because even right now, I'm not going to lie, like I am very cautious about it. I'm kind of anxious about what's happening. You know, it's very uncertain. Mm-hmm. You know, I've got like a little tickle in my throat right now, and it's
My allergies right now. Like it's crazy. Like you sneeze, and I'm like, oh man.
Allergies. Oh well, see, me and Nina the other night, we had to run to Target for something, and there's people wearing gloves and all that, and that sent my anxiety through the roof because I'm like, Jesus, one of these people has it. Like I just know it, and we avoided everyone still, but in the back of my mind, just how anxious I get sometimes, I'm sitting here thinking like, oh God, and now that my throat's kind of getting tickly, and I'm pretty sure it's from allergies from pollen because I've been outside a little bit, like sitting outside.
Bird right now.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's that, and she's telling me it's probably that, but in the back of my mind, I still can't help but shake the idea that I'm like, oh God, I've probably got this now, and so it's good to try to stay positive, but it's also for the sake of, you know, just everyone's safety, we need to stop going out. I mean, if you want to walk around your neighborhood, great and all that, but like you said, going to like stores and all that, unless it's an absolute need, don't do it. I mean, I told you my take on it. It's a little extreme, but for the people who don't take it seriously and continue to go out, I think they're just as much responsible as for the deaths of people from this virus as the virus itself is.
Yeah, well, it's your possibility of moving things around. And I saw a post that I actually liked, and it said, don't change your lifestyle thinking that you're living in a way to not get it. Change your lifestyle in a way that you would imagine that you do have it and how you don't want to spread it to others. So it's like, if everybody pretended like, because the big thing right now, as far as I can tell, is this whole asymptomatic thing. The people that can carry it without knowing that they have it. If everybody pretended they had it and put themselves on like a lockdown, maybe we wouldn't be giving it out to everybody, or we wouldn't spread as much, you know? Because we are hitting that peak of it right now, and I think the way they talked about it up until like...
What about that?
Huh?
You think we're hitting the peak?
No, I think we're going to. Like, the peak of it is supposed to be the number up until May 2nd is when the numbers
supposed to be.
Well, the numbers higher. Continue to rise until May 2nd. Depending on which computer graphed out things you look at. Mm-hmm. The one I saw was like, it was very interesting to me to see that May 2nd was the date that it'll hit its, like, whatever number, and then the day after May 3rd would be the first day that it would be a lower number than it was the day before. Because right now we're on that gradual climb for number of infected people. And what I saw was when things was projected that May 2nd will be the day that the number will finally start to come down if we do what we're supposed to do.
Yeah.
That's based on if we do what we're supposed to do. Think about it that way, people. If we don't do what we're supposed to do, then May 2nd, that date was picked based off of them going with people flattening the curve and not going up. If we continue to do this, that date gets pushed back. Now, it is a funny joking meme of saying, people, y'all need to stay in. I got things to do in June. But there's a truth to that. You know, like, this is not going to go away overnight. What's going to happen is it's going to hit its peak and it's going to finally then start to slow down. So it's not like we're going to continue like regular life right after all this. It's going to be a gradual go back out and go back and doing things and a gradual build up to normalcy. But it's going to take time. But if we don't do something about it now, then it gets to be a bit much.
Oh, I mean, yeah, totally. You think about it. Well, it's only been, 2 weeks since they've shut everything down?
Yeah.
If people would just take, like, I know you're probably bored in these 2 weeks, but think about it. If you're bored during these 2 weeks and you keep going out, you're stretching that date longer. Mm-hmm. You're not, I mean, I get that it's tough, but just, like, if you just stay put.
Just take your time and, like, find a way to, like, hey, I don't mean to, like, you know, just blow up our podcast or whatever. But find a way to be positive. Find a way to get better. Do something for yourself. Because in a way, you're being greedy by wanting to go out. So if you're going to go ahead and be greedy, go ahead and be greedy for yourself and figure out what it is that you can do for yourself at home to make yourself better. You know?
You seen the numbers? Have you seen the best case scenario and worst case scenario numbers that the CDC or the Surgeon General released the other day? Oh, man. So best case scenario, they said if everyone continues to do this flattening the curve thing, we're looking at anywhere from 100,000 to 200,000 deaths, which is a lot. If people didn't take it seriously and this was a free-for-all, we would be in the millions, he's been saying. He said it would be probably around like 1.6 million. And for me, seeing the best case scenario being anywhere from 100,000 to 200,000 is enough to scare me to not go out.
Yeah.
But for some people, they're just like, eh, like, you got to think about it. What if this was someone in your family? I mean,
yeah. That's why I said I like the one where it said, hey, think about it this way. Not like as in what would you do to keep from getting infected, but imagine you are, what can you do to keep from spreading it to someone else? So, but, you know, it's a crazy thing. It's kind of scary. It is scary. So,
it's totally scary.
You know, we're doing this, we're doing our part, we're doing, a co-hosted, you know, virtual podcast for everybody out there, you know. Now, positive is we figured out how to get everybody else on. So get Quasi, get in touch with Victoria Anthony, you know, David Taylor, Sariana, all you guys. We'll get you on screen as well. So now that we know how to do it all, then we can get all that figured out. But
yeah, no, it's, I mean, I, of course, that's the reason I wanted to do the Zoom stuff is just because right now it's, even though I didn't think y'all had it, or I don't even think I have it, or anything like
that. I think it's presenting the right way to do things.
Yeah, be cautious.
Being cautious and doing what we need to do for it. I think this is the way we should be doing things until they say, hey, it's okay to go out and social gather. We are not gathering unnecessarily. Obviously, we could have Tyler right here in the chair. But we're not meeting unnecessarily. We're trying to do our part. So for all of you guys out there, those about the Three Rivers Podcast, compounds 1 and 2 here on screen, we're trying to do our part. You guys try to do your part. And I think everybody, you know, this whole we can do this together thing, as corny as all that sounds, it's the truth. But you got to.
Yeah, it takes a team effort. Now, there's one thing that I am looking forward to at the end of this, not only just getting out of the house and stuff,
yeah.
But getting to see people again, like, just imagine the amount of almost like, it's kind of like after like a natural disaster, everyone kind of like comes together. It's like, you kind of really, you get a little bit closer through times like this. Cause like once you get to see people, it's like you, the people who do survive through this and the people, cause we're going to know that there's going to be people who aren't going to make it through this outbreak, unfortunately.
But so it'll be that much more a thing. And that's why, like I said, that's why I've been, you know, well, one, it's yard work, getting ready for summer and all that stuff anyway. But, man, get the yard right, get the grill going and stuff when it's all done and over. Have people over, you know, you come
over. Oh, yeah, I already know. I'm going out. Like, one, the minute everything's, you know, open up, I'm going to go out. I'm going to make sure, like, you know, I get to see some people, get some social interaction again, you know. Let people know, like, hey, I'm happy.
Bring Nina over. I'll lock up all my AA batteries, and then you know we'll have everybody. We'll be good to go.
I'll have to let her know you called her out on here.
Yeah, it's a way to get listeners. Normally I don't, because I don't really play that much. So my son plays, and like we do have a PS4. But I was just like, you know, I'm at home. I'm gonna mess with people now.
Man, I tell you the one thing I hate about this online learning stuff, though. You're talking about being at home. If, man, I do not have the attention span for it. I really don't.
Gosh. It's a completely different thing. You got to break it down into, like, people say, like, spend an hour or 30 minutes. No, 15 to 20 minutes, dude. You break yourself down in 15, 20 minutes and then force yourself to go take a break and then come back to it. You'll it's kind of like that study thing. You remember what you start and what you end with. And if all honesty, the more breaks this. Here's the kicker, though, and this is what I got to tell my own students and every other student that's listening while you're doing your e-learning, because I'm a big fan of the 15-minute thing. Study for 15 minutes. Do your e-learning. It's a video you're watching, whatever it is. Do 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, pause. Make yourself go do something else. Here's the discipline comes back in. You got to come back in 5 minutes. Anything past 5 minutes?
That's my biggest thing.
That if you don't come back in 5 minutes, though, then you're gone and you've forgotten. Now you only have 15 minutes worth versus like the whole hour of what you're supposed to get done. But I really think that if you people break things down into 15-minute chunks, you can get a lot more done and remember and retain a lot more than you can if you try to e-learn and just like kind of cram in all your videos into like an hour and a half block. So if you segment out 15 minutes here, take a 5-minute break, another 15 minutes, you know, that's 35 minutes, and that you should be able to knock out like at least one subject type thing. But if you can do 15 minutes goes and with, make sure you come back. I know that's my personal problem with something. Like if I, when I start doing that, like coming back in 5 minutes, like, oh no, it's been 25. And I forgot that I was supposed to be on task. So,
I hate it. Cause one of my classes is a study with my professor and it's just me and him.
Yeah. That's a little different. For the 15-minute rule, but
yeah. I kind of feel bad. Cause he's able to do all like the reading and stuff. He's able to do that. One, I'm not the fastest reader in the world. Cause I do get distracted, and especially cause the material's dense. It's like, so I get distracted easy. I kind of mentioned to him earlier, but I don't have the nerve to just come out and say, hey, look, I'm going to be behind because it's just, I'm sorry. I'm not able to do online very well at all. Like I just can't. Like it's
minus recording and us being over an hour. So
yeah, exactly. Like we'll record. Like me and him will do this same thing. We'll get on Zoom and we'll talk to each other, and it's easier that way. But sitting down and just like reading and trying to get the course information, like I don't like to use the word can, but I mean I definitely struggle doing it, and it's to the point where I'm a little bit behind. And I don't want them to think that I don't care. It's not
it's
that I don't care.
What I'm working.
It's just, it's what I'm working with right now. And it's very difficult for me to like get this done, but you know, the university told them to be more lenient about things. And
And that's the other thing is everybody needs to be a little bit more lenient with everybody right now too. So, you know, it's kind of with all this, cause it's all a new process for not a new process, but it's a new way when you're doing everything that way. Before people used to take online courses, a lot of times, unless you were working on another degree, but even when you were, it was kind of always at your own pace. And now that we're not at our own pace doing it and people are expecting things back, you know, we got to be a little bit lenient and say, hey, they're doing things from home. It's a different way. Got to take our time. Let's relax a little bit so everybody can get it all done without the added stress, because the stress isn't a good thing. So, but
Well, I guess that's a good place to end it for today. Yeah.
Cool. And I will try to get Nick on, and then we can pick up kind of like with some of this talk later on how to make things a little less stressful for you guys, if nothing else. And whatever other new wrestling news we got for you, we'll get it to you. All right.
Yeah, you got to tell me that story you were messaging me about.
I'll hit you up right now. Here, let me press the stop button, and we'll get it going.
All right.
Bye-bye. All right.